Hello, if you're just joining us, we are live from Anaheim, California at the 2016 Los Angeles Religious Education Congress, celebrating the theme of boundless mercy. Si apenas ha sintonizado nuestra transmisión en vivo de este Congreso 2016 de Los Ángeles de Educación Religiosa, gracias por su sintonía. Estamos a punto de comenzar el evento de apertura. We are about to begin the opening event. Everyone is gathered. There are dancers, musicians from throughout the Los Angeles Archdiocese that for the very first time are going to be processing in from the various corners of the arena. Es la primera vez que los músicos y los danzantes de las distintas regiones de Los Ángeles y del país van a procesar hacia el altar para este evento de apertura. Gracias por su sintonía. Soy Alex Venegas. I'm Alex Venegas. I'll be your host and commentator. Thank you. That was Tiana Falls from the St. Paul Assyrian Church of the East here in Anaheim, California, proclaiming the Lord's Prayer in Aramaic. Aramaic being the language that is purported to be spoken by Jesus during his time. We are preparing for the opening ceremony procession. We are hearing a call to worship. The drums are the heartbeat of the church, the heartbeat of a people. And we are being convoked to praise and worship our God. Esta es una llamada a la oración. Ese toque percusivo es semblanza del corazón palpitante del pueblo de Dios que se reúne para orar. that is Valimar Jansen, one of the cantors for the Congress. Convoking the church with Every Praise, a 2013 song by Jezekiah Walker and John David Bratton. Esa es Valimar Jansen, la cantora para el fin de semana, convocando a la Iglesia Universal a rendir toda alabanza y adoración con esta canción de Jezekiah Walker y John David Bratton. For the first time in the history of the Congress, we have the various musicians processing in. This is a testament to the fact that the musicians are part of the assembly and they're processing in from the people of God. Por primera vez en la historia del Congreso, sus 60 años, los músicos están procesando desde los distintos puntos de la arena, simbolizando que vienen y emanan desde el pueblo, la grey del Señor. Seeing the various cultures of the Archdiocese of Los Angeles represented in the various dancers that are processing in, singing Every Praises to our God. Minutes ago, we just saw Bishop Jose Gomez and Father Chris Bazyouros, the new director of religious education for the Archdiocese. He will be the keynote speaker for today's opening ceremony. Estamos observando las distintas etnias y culturas de la arquidiócesis representadas en los danzantes, en las familias que procesan. Hace unos minutos vimos a Monseñor José Gómez, arzobispo de Los Ángeles, y al Padre Chris Bazyouros, que es el nuevo director de educación religiosa para la arquidiócesis. Será el ponente principal.
With one. every word of worship with one accord.
Toda alabanza al Señor.
Every word of worship with one accord.
Hân hoan giáng mừng khen danh Cha.
Every word of worship.
This is a litany that is part of the opening song, Every Praise, and we've just heard invocations in Spanish, Vietnamese, and Tagalog. Again, a true testament of the multicultural, multi-ethnic nature of the church. Acabamos de escuchar letanías en español, vietnamita y tagalog, representando las distintas culturas de la diócesis.
Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us to be merciful like the Heavenly Father. You have told us that whoever sees you sees him. Show us your face, and we shall be saved. During this year of grace, let us hear, as if addressed to each one of us, the words you spoke to the Samaritan woman. If you knew the gift of God, send your spirit and consecrate every one of us with his anointing. Let the church be your visible face in the world, an instrument of your peace. You will that your ministers will also be clothed in weakness in order that they may feel compassion for those in ignorance and error. Let everyone who approaches them feel sought after, loved, and forgiven by God. We ask this of you, Lord Jesus, through the intercession of Mary, Mother of Mercy, you who live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit forever. Amen. Amen.
That was opening prayer by Bishop Jose Gomez, Archbishop of the Archdiocese of Los Angeles.
Padre fallado, contra ti he pecado.
Father, I have failed and I have sinned against
God
you.
God is approaching. God is coming near to us.
What should we expect?
When you come near me, I hesitate, I shrink back.
You approach me with your weapon drawn, armored, eyes hidden.
You come when you want me, on fire. I'm suspicious and defensive.
I clench my fists around my possessions and my life. I'm afraid of you.
So I'll join with you. We can get what we want.
We can take it from the weak.
We'll build a wall, guard the borders, and pass laws around what we take to protect it.
God is drawing near. God, who is life. God, who has nothing to do with death. God is approaching. Nothing. No one is like God. God has no rivals.
God will be like us. God made us like him, so God must want what we want. God must be rich and powerful.
Like us, yes. Jealous, vengeful, moody, miserable.
We get to decide what God likes. We decide what is good. And by doing that, we please God.
So we ask God to crush our enemies, those who are not like us, people who want what we have, who don't do the things that we say are good.
People who don't obey and worship, speak, dress, and act like we do.
God is approaching. God is drawing near.
What will God say to us?
What will God do to us?
What will God do to our enemies?
A voice speaks God's own name, mercy. God reveals a face.
It is the face of another human being.
It is the face of every other human being.
It is the face of Jesus Christ, who is hungry, who is thirsty,
who is in prison, who is sick,
who is naked,
who sleeps in a stable,
who welcomes friends, rivals, and enemies to the table,
who heals the sick, restores the castaway to community,
who calls God our Father,
who says that sins are already forgiven, who gives us a new start,
who says that God wants mercy, not sacrifice,
whose commandment is love one another.
And we killed him.
We killed him because we wanted the walls and the weapons.
We wanted the power of saying who's good and what's evil.
We wanted to control of God and everything and everybody else.
But God is approaching, drawing near in the risen Jesus,
whose word, after we killed him, is not revenge, but
shalom.
Who gives his life, his own life breathing to us who are afraid to breathe.
Receive the holy breath.
Who invites us to share the mission of mercy.
Be merciful as your Father is merciful.
A mission of service.
As the Father sent me, so I send you.
A mission of solidarity.
Love God. Love your neighbor like yourself. Love your enemies. God is approaching from everywhere, every time, all time.
Come near us, not like the gods we invented.
Not like the gods of retribution, violent and gluttonous.
Not like our national gods, preening, boastful, arrogant, demanding.
God draws near, bowing in service, strewing divine life across the universe, full of boundless mercy.
God draws near from within the eyes and heart of every friend, enemy, and stranger who approaches us.
God is drawing near.
Let us take these days to run towards the mercy that God offers, to leave behind the false gods of our own making.
Let us be merciful as God is merciful. Let us draw near to one another.
Let us be mercy.
Let us be mercy.
That was a four-person proclamation of opposites in the world today, a juxtaposition of the headlines that we hear every day in newspapers and throughout media, and a call to mercy. And it is a reflection that compels us to think of the times when we are not merciful. Esa fue una presentación por cuatro oradores de los opuestos en el mundo de hoy, la yuxtaposición de la misericordia que nos convoca el Papa Francisco y las líneas que vemos todos los días, las estadísticas.
Comes, who shall fear? You enfold me in your embrace. The vision of your face no dream could ever replace.
Was Boundless Love by Nguyen Van Thanh, translated into English by Brother Rufino Zaragoza, sung by Linda Nguyen from Mount St. Mary's College in Brentwood, California.
Me fui de tu lado y hoy derrotado regreso a ti.
I left your side, and now, completely defeated, I come back to you.
A reading from the book of the prophet Hosea. When Israel was a child, I loved him. Out of Egypt, I called my son. The more I called them, the farther they went from me. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk, who took them in my arms, but they did not know that I cared for them. I drew them with human cords, with bands of love. I fostered them like those who raise an infant to their cheeks. I bent down to feed them. How could I give you up, Ephraim? Or deliver you up, Israel? My heart is overwhelmed. My pity is stirred. I will not give vent to my blazing anger, for I am God and not a man, the Holy One present among you. I will not come in wrath. They shall follow the Lord who roars like a lion, and I will resettle them in their homes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That was a scripture that was proclaimed in English and simultaneously in American Sign Language, as a respect and homage to our deaf community here in the Church of Los Angeles.
My Savior has rest on me.
That was Amazing Grace, the traditional hymn by John Newton, as performed by Ryan Klaus, Sarah Hart, and Harrison Crenshaw, with Chris Tomlin's 2006 adaptation known as My Chains Are Gone. Dear son, you were lost.
We pray for those who call us to life-giving waters.
For humble leaders who reverence others in words, deeds, and actions.
For ministers who summon us to return to God with all our hearts.
Oh, Lord.
for the leaders who summon the world's people to a change of heart.
For the ones who work tirelessly for lasting peace.
For prophets who lay down their lives for others.
Oh Lord.
For soldiers, pilgrims, students, missioners and aid workers, prisoners, immigrants, and refugees.
For those separated by old fears and hurts.
For the ones who return to places of welcome and forgiveness.
For the children of God, whose nights are filled with terror and the thunder of angry weapons.
For those whose needs are for the most basic necessities of life. The hungry, naked, the lonely, the homeless, and the hopeless.
For the people who yearn to return to the church, and for those who will welcome them.
Oh Lord.
And today, repentant, you've been reborn and you've come beside me.
Good morning, church. Buenos dias, iglesia. Thank you. It is always our great privilege to welcome you this year to the 60th Annual Religious Education Congress. Con felicidad les extendemos un caloroso bienvenido a todos de ustedes en el 60º Congreso de Educación Religiosa de Los Ángeles. Siempre me llena el corazón con alegría a ver tantas personas que se reúnen cada año de encontrar a Dios en sus prójimos en oración y en la palabra. Y qué bendición maravillosa de celebrar este aniversario de nosotros durante el jubileo extraordinario de misericordia. For 60 years, The Archdiocese of Los Angeles has offered catechists and teachers and all the faithful an opportunity to grow in their faith and renew their commitment to this most important task of catechesis. And it fills my heart with joy to see all of you gathered here this morning, to see all of your faces and your hearts full of joy to begin this wonderful experience together as we come together for 4 days to an encounter with God, in each other, in the Word, and in prayer. I would certainly like to thank Archbishop Gomez for all of his support in our preparation for this, and especially in my first year as director. So thank you so much, Archbishop Gomez, for your support. As you know, Congress begins with Youth Day, and yesterday we received over 13,000 young people who filled this area with all their joy and their energy. It was an awesome spirit. And I would certainly like to give thanks to the Youth Ministry Division, the Youth Day Core Team, all their helpers and volunteers who made that day such a wonderful experience of God's joy. So thank you so much for all of your hard work. You know, there is a saying, we must work hard to leave a better world for our children. We've heard that before, yes? Well, recently I heard a response to that saying that says, why do we never say we must work hard to leave better children for our world? Yesterday we had an opportunity to see some of those better children. We got to see so many young people on fire for their faith, ready to share that faith and open their hearts to an encounter with Jesus. And in that, they reminded us that all of our journeys begin with hope. That was their theme, hope bound. And hope is a special purview of the young. In each young person, there lies a joyful seed of hope, no matter how small. And within that hope sleeps a dream for a world that is kinder, gentler, and more full of life. In the theme Hope Bound, our young people gather to nurture that seed of hope and to learn new ways to allow it to flourish. Two things I learned from Youth Day this year: that theme Hope Bound was not a coincidence. Every journey to seek the mercy of God begins when hope is kindled in the heart. And so our young people gather together to remind us that hope is now catching fire, to move us to journey and to seek God's mercy. And then the second thing is, their theme actually is hashtag hopebound. And to those of us of a certain age, it looks like the pound sign. But I'm not looking at anybody in particular. But we know in social media that the hashtag allows a term to be searchable, allows it to be easy to find. And by the young people choosing hashtag hopebound, they reminded us that we should make it easy to find God's mercy. We should make God's love and mercy easily searchable and discoverable. So I want to thank those young people for reminding us and beginning us on our weekend. When our staff got together to discern this year's theme, our Holy Father, Pope Francis, had recently announced the Year of Mercy. So, of course, the entire staff was just on fire. How are we going to express this during this wonderful weekend of Congress? And we just had all kinds of things were going all over the place. We had oceans of mercy. We had rivers of mercy. We had mountains of mercy. I mean, we had a great topography. You could almost find it on Google Maps. It was something else. But what we were really searching for was something to express how God's mercy is not constrained. Many times in our life, we just feel constrained and caught up, either trapped by our past or constrained by what is happening in our lives. And sometimes we can even feel that God can't reach us. And so we settled on the theme, boundless mercy, to remind us that God's love has no limits. And Pope Francis, he wrote that so beautifully in his letter, Misericordiae Vultus, as he writes in paragraph 3, mercy will always be greater than any sin, and no one can place limits on the love of God who is ever ready to forgive. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That message of mercy is so beautifully displayed in the gospel reading for this Sunday as Jesus converses with the Samaritan woman at the well. In this beautiful display of grace and mercy, Jesus opens to this woman a new horizon for her life. In the beginning of the conversation, the woman brings up all the reasons why they shouldn't be talking to each other. And Jesus even talks, so he mentions a couple more, actually five more, if you remember the reading. But even in all of that, Jesus gently and patiently allows the conversation to continue because he knows that what this woman is seeking, he is able to give. And he expressed it so beautifully as we heard earlier today. If you knew the gift of God and what this woman did not even know or understand, Jesus knew he was to give. In this simple and gentle conversation, Jesus opens this woman's life to a new reality, not by dismissing her life as irrelevant, but helping her to recognize her search. And sometimes we go through life completely ignorant of the thirst that drives us, the thing that within our own hearts we long for. And so we seek that satisfaction in all kinds of ways. And gently, Jesus continues that dialogue with our heart, as we heard so beautifully in our reading this morning. He draws us to himself with bands of love. And in that drawing near to us, he reminds us that in Jesus, we find that source of life-giving water. I find this so beautifully expressed in this poem by Mary Oliver, which is titled Thirst. Another morning, and I wake with thirst for the goodness I do not have. I walk out to the pond, and all the way, God has given us such beautiful lessons. O Lord, I was never a quick scholar, but sulked and hunched over my books past the hour and past the bell. Grant me, in your mercy, a little more time. Love for earth and love for you are having such a long conversation in my heart. Who knows what will finally happen or where I will be sent, except I will be told to pack nothing except the prayers which, with this thirst, I am slowly learning. I think sometimes in our modern day, we forget that we are on a journey of faith. We are on a journey towards the mercy of God, and that God is infinitely patient with us on that journey. We must always recognize and acknowledge not only that thirst that drives us, but where we can find satisfaction for that thirst, which is only in Jesus.
Viviendo en una zona de que está sufriendo una sequía dura y larga, conocemos bien el deseo de buscar un fuente de agua que es clara, limpia, dulce y que nos sostiene. Lamentamos nuestro egoísmo y avaricio mientras nuestra tierra pierde, por la falta de agua, la memoria de sentirse la vida creciendo adentro de ella. Esta misma sequía puede penetrar nuestra alma también y nos afecta en todas partes, en la vida familiar, en nuestro ministerio, en nuestro tiempo de oración con el Señor y últimamente a todo nuestro ser. Y por eso, este año de misericordia nos recuerda a fijar en la fuente de la vida que es Jesucristo. En las palabras del Beato Monseñor Oscar Romero, Jesús es la fuente de la esperanza. En Jesús se fundamenta lo que predico.
The gentleness and patience of Jesus continues to draw us to him, to awaken us to that great gift of God that he offers.
Henry Wadsworth Longfellow wrote, "If we could read the secret history of our enemies, we should find in each one's life sorrow and suffering to disarm all hostility." One of the most beautiful parts of the gospel is when the evangelists give us a glimpse of the inner life of Jesus in his emotions and in his thoughts. There are several moments that describes where Jesus is moved to the depth of his being, or Jesus is moved with compassion. And scripture scholars like to say that's kind of a tame way of translating the verb. The verb, esplagnitze. Let's all say that together. Esplagnitze. You got your Greek lesson for the day. It means a churning of the guts. It means that he's moved down in the deep part of himself. When he sees people who are suffering, who are sick, those who are without guidance, without direction, his entire being is moved profoundly. And Jesus responds to that with the fullness of God's grace. We heard of that so beautifully in the document Gaudium et Spes, the pastoral constitution on the church in the modern world. As the beginning of the document, a sentence with which all of us are very familiar, as it says, "The joys and the hopes and the griefs and the anxieties of people of this age are the same griefs and anxieties, the joys and the hopes of the people of God." But the sentence right after that, I think, is so key. "Indeed, nothing genuinely human fails to raise an echo in their hearts." In Jesus, in the incarnation, he brings to humanity the fullness of God's love. And everything that has a resonance within the human experience, the depths of our sorrow, the heights of our joys, the anxieties, all of those have found a place in the heart of Jesus. And he draws all of those experiences into himself to transform them so that his mercy can be ever present to us. But we are all, many times, we're a little bit slow to allow that mercy to be a part of our lives. Instead, we hold on to those things that have hurt us. We hold on to those things that have diminished us and our fear to move forward. In the letter of Pope Francis, Misericordiae Vultus, he talks about the parable of the prodigal son and how important it is as ministers of the church and those who serve the people of God to continuously extend the mercy of God, not just to the son who wandered, but especially to the son who couldn't enter into the feast. He says, for us, it's important to go out to the older son and explain to him that his judgment is severe and unjust and meaningless in the light of the Father's boundless mercy. In short, to be a sign of the primacy of mercy always, everywhere, and in every situation, no matter what. Everywhere, always, every situation. But yes, we're called to experience and to share God's mercy in all of those ways. But it's difficult for us. We hold on to old ideas. We hold on to those fears. We hold on to a strange understanding of what mercy means. Growing up, my brothers and I have three brothers, two older brothers and a younger brother. And we had this game we played, and it was called Mercy, but there was nothing merciful about it. I don't know if you played it yourself. You know, it's where you clench hands like this, and you squeeze as hard as you can, and the first one to give up has to shout, "Mercy!" When I got to be bigger than all my brothers, they stopped playing that game with me. I don't know why. But a lot of society today holds that idea of mercy, that it's a position of weakness that we should never find ourselves experiencing. But as we go on in life, we realize it is in our weaknesses that we encounter the great mercy and strength of God. And without embracing that, without realizing that in those times of weakness, that that is where we are called to trust in God completely. Soon after the Paris attacks, there was a cute interview between a French journalist and a man and his five-year-old son. And the journalist was asking the five-year-old boy, who was so cute answering in French, if he understood what was going on. And the little boy, 5 years old, he says, yes, some bad guys came in with guns and hurt people. And he says, well, how do you feel about that? He says, well, I'm kind of scared and I'm really sad and we have to move now. And that kind of alerted the father. And the father asked him, we don't have to move. Why do we have to move? And the little boy says, well, there are bad guys here. And they're going to hurt us with guns. And the father says, well, there's bad people everywhere. We're not going to move. But the little boy was unconvinced. He says, no, they have their guns. They're going to hurt us. And the father responds, well, they have guns, but we have flowers. And the little boy's like, flowers? He's like, flowers, flowers won't work. Fine. He was trying to figure out how that worked. And the father turned and he directed the attention of his son to the place where people were laying flowers and candles. He said, you see those flowers and candles? We're remembering those who were hurt, those who died. You see all those people laying flowers there? He says, yes. He says, they're there to remind us. Now, the little boy was thinking that, oh, maybe these flowers will protect us. But everyone could see what the father was doing. He was teaching his son to protect his heart against fear. He was teaching his son to respond in mercy and in compassion. And that is a lesson that is sorely needed today, which is why it is so important during this year of mercy not to allow those fears to restrain our hearts, but instead to allow the mercy and compassion of God to free us from the traps of fear, that Christ reveals his love in God's mercy and it sets us free. As Maya Angelou would say, in the flush of love's light, we dare be brave, and suddenly we see that love costs all we are and will ever be. Yet it is only love which sets us free. The desire to be in solidarity, the desire to help others, reminds us to be attentive to the suffering and pain of others. It reveals how our humanity is transformed in Christ, how we arrive at that true humanity, which is aware of others' sufferings and needs. The moment we stop responding to suffering and pain by placing flowers and candles, when we stop lining up to donate blankets or food or blood, when we stop reaching out and bending down low to help, that's the moment we have stopped living mercy, the moment we have lost our humanity. And if we lose our humanity, how can we ever come to know and love the God of mercy who became human to save us? The desire to be in solidarity, to respond by helping, reflects that our true humanity comes from our awareness of our weakness, our need for each other, but it also comes from the awareness that through God in Christ, we have all we ever need. So now, what do? We seek the mercy of God. We open our hearts to that mercy. Now what? And now we realize that this year of mercy is not meant to be a short time, one and done and over. Instead, this year of mercy is meant to be a boot camp. It's meant to train us up in the ways of the mercy of God. That the mercy of God does not only settle in our hearts, but it begins to flow through our bones and our muscles and our blood and our mind and our heart to move us into the world, to move us into those places of hurt and suffering and pain and fear, and to bring the compassion of God. Fred Rogers of the neighborhood
He once shared that when he was young and he saw things that were scary, his mother would say, "Look for the helpers. In times of tragedy, there are always helpers." That is our role. Do not shy away from suffering. Do not say, "Well, I'll pray for you. I hope the good luck with that." But instead, to reach out that hand in compassion, to journey with others, to be there as a presence of Christ, to create in this world a culture of mercy, a place where people will always associate the mercy of God with his people. And in so doing, to show the face of Christ in all that we do and that we say. Henry Nouwen, in his book, The Return of the Prodigal Son, he talks about how, as he's contemplating this image of the son returning home, he realizes that his own journey as the repentant son is merely a step on the way to becoming the welcoming father. And that is our journey as well, that we are on our way, becoming the repentant son, the repentant daughter, and soon to become like the merciful father. As he says, "I now see that the hands that forgive, console, heal, and offer a festive meal must now become my own." And so, my brothers and sisters, as we go forward in this wonderful weekend of joy, love, mercy of God, and of learning, I close with these words from the poet Maya Angelou. "Words are things, I'm convinced. You must be careful about the words you use or the words you allow to be used in your house. Someday we'll be able to measure the power of words. I think they are things. I think they get on your walls, they get in your wallpaper, they get in your rugs and your upholstery, in your clothes, and finally, into you." Our prayer and our hope for all of us during this weekend is that the boundless mercy of God may get into your walls and in your wallpaper and in your rugs and in your upholstery and into your clothes and into us. God bless you and have a wonderful weekend in Christ.
That was Father Chris Bazyouros, Director of Religious Education for the Archdiocese of Los Angeles, giving an uplifting keynote speech, quoting the poet Maya Angelou. Ese fue el padre Chris Bazyouros, director de educación religiosa para la Arquidiócesis de Los Ángeles, dándonos un mensaje positivo de esperanza y misericordia en este tiempo.
Estabas perdido, y hoy arrepentido has revivido, ven junto a mí. Oh Señor de amor y compasión, me has salvado tu perdón. Oh Señor, te doy mi corazón, a ti hoy vuelvo tuyo soy. Padre, he fallado, contra ti he pecado, me fui de tu lado y hoy derrotado regreso a ti. Ven, hijo querido, estabas perdido, y hoy arrepentido has revivido, ven junto a mí. Oh Señor, tu amor y compasión, Señor, hay que fiel.
estoy, aquí me quedo, tuyo soy.
Padre fallado, contra ti he pecado, me pide en tu lado y hoy derrotado regreso a ti. Ven, hijo querido, estabas perdido, yo he arrepentido, has revivido, ven junto a mí.
Santiago Fernandez, Anna Betancourt, Dolores Gomez, Pedro Rubalcaba, and Peter Kolar performing Junto a Mí by Santiago Fernandez.
Before the good morning to everyone. Buenos días. Ya están listos, eh? All right. Before the closing prayer, I also want to welcome all of you to our 2016 Religious Education Congress, Boundless Mercy. It is, as Father Chris reminded us, a moment of grace for all of us. And I wanted to share with you that this past week, I had the blessing of being with Pope Francis. Pope Francis. I was blessed to co-celebrate Mass with him in Ciudad Juarez, Mexico. It was a beautiful Mass. A joyful Eucharistic celebration. We were about 350,000 people. So a little more than our Congress. But I had the opportunity to talk to Pope Francis for a few minutes, and he sent his blessing for all of you and your families attending the Religious Education Congress 2016. So. Let us especially keep him in our prayers. Vamos a rezar especialmente por el Papa Francisco este fin de semana. I've been reflecting during these months of the Year of Mercy about two things that can be useful for all of us. The first one is that the people of our times want to know if mercy is real. And if it is, they want to know where can mercy be found. That's why Pope Francis says that the church must be a credible witness to mercy. And that's what Father Chris was talking to us about. So let's reflect on how important it is for each one of us to be a credible witness to mercy. And then I've also been reflecting on how important it is for us to make mercy our project as a church in this Jubilee year to come. Mercy is our mission as Christians. So let us try, in all our ministries, in every area of our lives, to walk with our brothers and sisters, to make the merciful presence of God known in the world. So have a wonderful weekend. Que tengan un bonito fin de semana. I'm sure that you are anxious to go to the workshops right now. And you didn't have breakfast before this. Sorry about that. No les va a dar tiempo. So let us ask for the intercession of Mary, our Blessed Mother, to have a wonderful 2016 Religious Education Congress, boundless in mercy. Please stand. Are you okay? Let us pray. O God, Father of all mercies, your love and patience is displayed in countless ways around us. Yet many times we fail to recognize you. Over these 3 days of the Religious Education Congress, plant the seeds of compassion and courage deep within our hearts. Do not let us live here without being changed by your loving presence. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
We're now going to hear our theme song this year, Boundless Mercy, as written by Meredith Augustine from New York City. And we ask you to stay with us for continued programming throughout the weekend. And we have our first keynote at 10 a.m. this morning. Thank you so much. God bless you.
Mercy.
Boundless mercy.
Misericordia inagotable.
To the voice of God calling, come my child and drink of my water and live in joy and peace. Your love and boundless mercy bring healing to the soul, renew the weary spirit and quench our
We decided to bring you out here to the main floor of the arena so that you could experience the fervor and the joy that emanates from this place. We are just a minute away from having concluded the opening ceremony. And I have a first-time Congress attendee. Her name is Kristen. How are you?
I'm very good. How are you?
And tell us what city you're from, what parish you're from, and what your ministries you're involved in.
I am from Woodbridge, New Jersey. I am the Director of Music and Liturgy and Youth Ministry.
For what parish?
Lady of the Church of Our Assumption. It's a long name.
So what motivated you to come to Congress for the very first time?
My best friend went last year, and a lot of my friends are involved higher up in the whole situation, the whole foundation, so I wanted to come and see them.
That's perfect. So of this opening event, what stood out to you from a message perspective or just a song, a prayer, something that you witnessed?
Curtis Stephen playing the trumpet. He can do everything. It's disgusting. He's so talented. I can't believe it. He sings, he plays, he writes. That was it for me. Just now. He just did it.
That's awesome. And what would you tell people who haven't had the opportunity to come? How would you motivate them to, you know, attend next year with their parish community? What would you say to them?
I would say save your pennies. Start now. You have a whole year. Get ready to go. Oh, and Meredith Augustin, oh my gosh, her song is so beautiful. Come to hear her. She's brilliant. Here she is. She's right behind you.
Thank you so much. And here she is in all her glory.
Bye, Kristen. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you so much, Kristen. This is Meredith Dean Augustin, and she composed this year's theme song. How are you, Meredith?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing fabulous, and you just really led this entire assembly in song with a theme, Boundless Mercy. How did you write the song? What was your methodology?
My methodology was all about mercy. I took a look at the readings, especially the gospel that we heard about in Father Chris's homily there. Mercy and the boundless mercy of God.
And one of the things that stood out to me is that you're not a native Spanish speaker, and you wrote in Spanish. What was that process like?
Sí, muy difícil.
Muy difícil.
Porque misericordia inagotable does not roll off the tongue very easily.
Exactly.
But I had beautiful guides who walked with me the whole time to make sure that my T's weren't too hard.
That was beautiful. And you brought salsa from New York City to Los Angeles.
Yes.
What was that whole experience like?
Amazing. I love rhythm so much, especially the Latin rhythms. Especially the Haitian rhythms too. They all kind of come together. But I think salsa is, rhythms just bring people together, and I really love salsa.
And you work with some very talented musicians in the recording and in the construction of the theme song. Talk to us about who they are and what they contributed to the project.
Wow, okay, well the biggest help to me is one of my dear friends, John Benitez, who is a Grammy Award winning bassist. He's from Puerto Rico. Just a brilliant musician. So I was able to work with him and all of the musicians that come along with him to create boundless mercy.
Well, we thank you so very much for your ministry. And for those of you who don't know where you are, where can they find you as a musician and you as an artist? Because I hear you have an album.
I do. I am published by World Library Publications. I'm so grateful for their support. So World Library has the new record, Boundless Mercy. Physically, you can find me at the Church of St. Francis of Assisi in Midtown Manhattan.
Thank you so much for your boundless mercy, and we love you, and God bless you.
Thank you. I love you, too. Have a great weekend.
Thank you, Meredith.
Bye.
Appreciate it. Okay, so we have other brothers and sisters that are part of the music ministry here in the Archdiocese of Los Angeles. Please tell us who you are and what you're doing this weekend.
My name is Chris Nuno, and I'm here at worship. I'm here at this wonderful Congress. This is my second year, so I'm just loving every minute of it. And I'm here to, you know, just praise and worship God's name. And, you know, we'll also be singing as well tomorrow for the Young Adult Mass.
Awesome. And tell us a little bit about yourself.
My name is Lauren. We're both from Transfiguration Church in South LA. And we, you know, just here worshiping with the opening ceremony, singing in the choir. And like you said, we'll be singing tomorrow at the Young Adult Mass with Meredith, who wrote the theme song for the weekend. So
that's awesome. And remember you last year when you did a Grateful, that amazing song, Grateful. Talk to us about what it's been like to journey in the Congress space and the various liturgies and masses, etc.
It's been, you know, amazing. You know, when they had asked me and they asked us to do it, you know, I felt so honored, you know, just to be a part of that. And, you know, it's such a wonderful experience to just be here. You know, I enjoy it so much.
And what exactly drew you to Congress? Because we met you last year and you've decided to come back. Where do you guys normally worship and what has inspired you to come back?
Well, we would come years before just to be a part of the Congress, and we're music ministers in our local parish at, like I said, Transfiguration. So John invited us. I know John through LMU because I'm a student at LMU. So he invited us to be a part of the opening, and we were like, yeah, sure, we'll do it. So this is a different experience, and it's great to be like with everyone from the Archdiocese and from different parts of the world and the country. So.
And how are you guys celebrating the theme of mercy in your own lives this year?
Well, you know, what we're doing is, you know, we're just spreading the word, you know, trying to touch lives, really being here and just connecting with everyone. And last year, you know, I felt really moved when I had people come up to me, you know, after we had did Grateful for the opening ceremony, and just the things that they said, you know, and people shedding tears about how they were touched. And I feel through music and song, you know, we can do that. We can just change lives and help to spread that news.
Well, thank you so very much for your ministry. God bless you, and we hope to see you again next year. Have a great day. Thank you. Hi. So we're joined by Jeremy and Ryan, who did a fantastic job yesterday, Youth Day. And we saw you again up in the choir and participating in the opening ceremony. What was it like with such festive ambiance this morning?
It was fantastic. I mean, we come from growing up with all of these fantastic singers, Steve Anchorzano, John Ungadi, David Haas, and for us, it was an honor to be here sharing God's love and God's mercy through our music, and then, of course, seeing this whole arena singing and just feeling so blessed.
How about you, Ryan?
It was an amazing experience, an honor to be here, like he said, to be able to come up front and sing as well. And Youth Day, again, it was our third time playing Youth Day. We love every year we come, and to be able to celebrate with these kids, just to see that energy about God's love that they all put out there, and we can help facilitate with our praise and worship that we do for them.
What are you guys going to be doing this weekend in terms of events, workshops, and concerts?
As far as this weekend, we don't have a lot of responsibilities music-wise, but we are going to try to share our talents and our gifts of just walking around, networking, and finding out how other people are sharing their mercy and things like that.
And how are you using the merciful theme throughout the year in your various events and in your ministry?
We understand that everybody's coming from a place of struggle. We're all a little bit broken. We're trying to find our wholeness with God, and that every person that we meet, you know, like, we can share something with them and they can share their lives with us, and we can just love a little bit more.
Any other words for our listeners and those that are following the webcast from you, Ryan?
Though we're not doing much as far as he said responsibilities for the weekend, we're going to be around and you might see us playing some acoustic sets, maybe outside with a cajon and a guitar. We want to just be involved and share our love with everyone as much as we can.
All right. Thank you so very much, guys. Have a blessed weekend. Take care of yourselves. Well, thank you so much for your continued support of the live webcast. We're minutes away from starting our first workshop here in the arena. God bless you. Follow along www.recongress.org. And we have our amazing cantor, Valimar Jansen, who's just joined us here stage side. Val, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you.
We were all very moved by that opening song, Every Praise. And for the first time, you had the music ministers emanate from the different corners of the arena. Wasn't that just an amazing experience?
It was. I love the fact that when we gather, it's everyone. The gathering doesn't start for us when the gathering processional song begins. The gathering starts when we're coming from every city, every corner of the United States and beyond here at the LA Congress. So the idea of people coming from all over and coming forward to give worship and praise was really an amazing experience.
It really was. And then the use of the traditional African American prayer for the prayer of the faithful. When you delve into that kind of song, where do you go in terms of a prayerful space?
I go beyond the obvious in terms of slavery and freedom, physical slavery and physical freedom, but beyond that to being freed from sin, being freed from misery, being freed from poverty, being freed from ignorance. So I'm thinking of all of those corporal and spiritual works of mercy that we're embodying and that we're talking about and living during this year of mercy.
And how are you experiencing that theme this year in your own ministry, in your own profession as a college professor? How is it imbued in your life?
What I do is when I go out, I teach through song and through storytelling and through reflection, prayer, and scripture. And so what I'm teaching is that we are to have that kind of mercy for the world that Christ had, which is mercy that has no limits. And the way that I do that is to hopefully teach people, and in my own life, my own personal life, of forgiving those who sometimes don't even feel like they need your forgiveness. You know, but forgive them. This is a year to forgive people, to come together, to forgive, and to forgive for good. You know, so I find that theme is working its way into every parish mission, every youth rally, all that I do. That theme is kind of working its way into everything I'm doing this year.
Well, thank you so very much, Val. Have a great and blessed weekend, and we thank you for your ministry.
Oh, I appreciate you so much. Thank you.
All right, so thank you so much for your continued support. We are going to be here throughout the weekend. We hope that you follow us and that you engage on social media, participating with us in this prayerful and spiritual event. Thank you so much. Stay tuned.
Nobody now but yours. No.